The stories you've already heard came from that particularly productive pandemic time. This particular story was told before the pandemic, but really, I had just started telling it. And so I'm allowing myself the gift of sharing this with you because it is truly one of my favorites. It's called Giddy Up's Fiddle Dancer, and it's dedicated to my friends Josh Goforth and Sheila K. Adams, both from Madison County, North Carolina. Jeremiah Goodman was just 4 years old when he sang his first folk song, one of them old ballads that he had learned from his Aunt Sheila and his mama and his grandma. He loved those old ballads. And when he would sing, his black curly hair would flow down to his neck and his sparkling blue eyes would light up. He loved singing them songs. And then he started playing the fiddle. His granddaddy taught him the fiddle and he loved playing that old fiddle. And he learned those fiddle songs real quick-like. Matter of fact, everything he wanted to learn, he learned quick. And he couldn't help but learn those fiddle songs and sing those ballads, because all around him, that's what folks did up in the mountains. And the mountains were just a part of who he was. He loved going out into the mountains and climbing up through those trees, seeing the paw prints from the bear and the squirrel and the rabbit, seeing the trees point the tips up to the sky, watch the rock formations and realize that the mountain was bigger than anything he knew except God himself. Oh, he loved being in the mountains, Jeremiah. And he grew and he grew and he grew, singing them old songs and playing them old fiddles. Well, by the time that he was 10 years old, he knew just as many ballads as his Aunt Sheila did. And he was still learning more. And that's when his grandpapa died and left him the fiddle, which he played real well. He played so well. By the time he was 13 years old, well, folks, they loved to have him play and were always inviting him to come to the stage. He would play so well that his whole body looked like he wanted to dance to the music he played. And they would say, get on now, go on now, Jeremiah, get on now, get it up, get it up, get it up. And soon enough, that's what everybody called him, Giddy Up. And Giddy Up could play. Oh, he loved what he did. But then around 18 years of age, as he was getting ready to finish his schooling, Giddy Up realized that the mountains were holding him in and he wanted to be let out. Well, it just so happened during that time that some man from England, some British man come over trying to write down those old Scots-Irish ballads and had been told to come over there to where he lived in the mountains. And that British man talked to his Aunt Sheila and his mama and his grandma, and they taught him those songs. And of course, his mama said, well, you can't leave here till you hear my son, Jeremiah. And Jeremiah came out and he played some tunes on that there fiddle and sang ballads of his own. So much so that that British man said, well, son, if you'd like to come to England, I'll take you all around. Jeremiah was as happy as he could be. And once he finished that schooling, he took that ticket and went on over to England. And there in England, that British man took him all around. He played so well, and then British folk got out of their seats and they danced like they had never danced before. And he went and traveled to Ireland, Scotland, sharing songs that some folks hadn't heard in a long time. He made his way on down to Italy and Germany, over to places he always thought about. And every time he played, his song playing got better and better. Folks loved it. And he loved every experience he had. But after being there for about a year, his heart started longing for the mountains. And the truth be, the mountains were longing for him. So he gathered himself up about a year and two, and he'd made a good passel of money and brought himself back home. When he got home, the only thing he did was buy himself a car. He decided not to work a little bit, but just to play with folks. He had enough to do that. And so folks would call on him and say, "Giddy up, can you come on over and play this evening?" And he always said yes, and never asked for a dime. Folks would call on him and he'd come. And there'd be somebody with the bass and somebody else with the banjo, maybe a harmonica over there, maybe another fiddle that was there. Somebody with the washboard on him. And he'd come, and when he got there, they'd already be tuned up. And he'd come on that stage, and he'd have a stool there, and he'd take that old fiddle case of his granddaddy's, and he'd place it on that stool, click up the latches, and he'd take out that fiddle. With one hand, he'd hold that fiddle, and the other one would close those latches up and put that case on the ground. He always, of course, took out that other bow there that was there, and he would take that fiddle and put that fiddle underneath his chin, and his chin would rest on a chin strap that was worn smooth from all the chins that had been on it. And he'd take that bow and cross that bow over his head, and he'd pluck those fingers, pluck those strings, indeed. He'd pluck them one and two and three. And then he'd take that bow and put them over those strings. And when he was ready, he'd look at the band and he'd nod and say, "You about ready?" "Sure enough, giddy up." And then he'd look at everybody that was waiting for giddy up to start to play. And he said, "Well, let's get started." And putting that fiddle underneath his chin, he raised his bow and he started to play. Oh, he played real pretty. His leg just a moving and a shaking. But if anybody had been watching, they would notice about that time when Jeremiah's eyes closed and he was playing from a deep place. If they had taken the time to notice, they would have noticed there was a young man that would come in to wherever they were dancing at right then. If they had taken the time to notice, they would have wondered why he seemed to have the same kind of clothes on that Jeremiah had on. And if they take the time to look even further, they might wonder, well, he sure enough looked like Giddy Up. Mm-hmm. Could be a cousin or something. But no one ever wondered because they were too busy looking at Giddy Up on that stage. But the one that came in, he looked like he wanted to dance. And so he started looking for that one. Oh, you know who that one is. Come on now, why don't you think about it? You know who that one is. It's the one, the girl that's standing over there. She might be in the middle of the room. Her legs are moving and her feet are tapping and her shoulders are going up and down. Her body just wants to dance, but nobody has asked her for a dance yet. He would go to that one and come over to that one and take her by the arm and swing her around. And I tell you, that girl and that fiddle dancer, they would dance and dance and dance. He'd throw up in the air and down to the ground. They'd swing all around and, well, everybody else decided to dance too. And that's when folks would forget to be a looking and just be a listening and a moving. And after a little bit, there would come a man, come on over to where he was dancing, that fiddle dance, and ask if he could have a turn with this good lady. And he always said yes and watched them as they go on the floor. But then that fiddle dancer would start looking all around, looking for that one. I know you know about that one. You've seen her too. She's the one that stands on the wall, far to the back. She don't have no pretty ribbons to put in her hair. Her hair hangs stringy and don't look real pretty. Her dress be homey-like, nothing fancy like the girls she see out there. Her foot be tapping, but she know nobody gonna ask her to dance. But that fiddle dancer, he come on over to where she be. And he lift up her head and look in the eye. And she dropped her head down, all embarrassed like. And he lift up her head again and look in the eye. And then he take a hand and he pull her onto the floor. And he swing her around. And he dance with her, moving back and forth until she starts feeling like the belle of the ball. She feel beautiful. And she dance and dance. And fiddle dancer stays with her until a young man come up and tap him on the shoulder and say, "Can I have a dance with this pretty one?" And the fiddle dancer let her go. And then the fiddle dancer started looking around again until his eyes would light on that one. She was older, watching over the young folk, making sure no trouble come around, sitting in a chair by herself, every now and then looking at them dancing, but the whole while turning the ring on her finger, thinking of the one she used to dance with, who was gone now. And she turned that ring around and around. And that fiddle dancer come over to her and take her by both hands and lift her up. But he don't swing her on the floor. No, he bring her in real close. One arm round her waist, the other one a little further down, bringing her close and moving her from side to side real slow. Until that woman laid her head on his chest and felt like she was dancing with the one she loved. And they danced there a while until that woman, she back up a bit, lean back against his arms that she knew would hold him fast, hold her fast, and look up in that fiddle dancer's eyes and then lean up and kiss him right on the cheek. And he'd help her back to a chair. And now she was smiling, remembering the one she loved. That fiddle dancer danced with woman after woman after woman. Indeed he did. And well, the women, they would get curious. And they'd ask questions. "What's your name? Who are your peoples? Are you married? Got a girlfriend?" He never answered them, just laughed and swirled them around on the floor again. And if anybody noticed, when there was a moment for a break for the band, they would have wondered, where did that fiddle dancer go? They probably just thought he went outside with the young men who took a little something out of their pockets to have a drink, or maybe he was just admiring the young ladies who gathered and they had a little something to drink as well. But when giddy up and the band started again, well, that fiddle dancer was right there dancing with everybody. They would dance long into the early wee mornings. Somewhere around 2 or 3 o'clock, there would be Jeremiah, giddy up himself, and he would stop and say, "Well, folks, we've been here a good long time, and it's been mighty fine to play with these folks up here, but about time for us to get on home." And at that, he would go over and pick up his case, and he flipped the latches again, and he wouldn't put his fiddle in right there or the bow. He left him on the stool, and he would say, as he turned that case around to the front of the stage, he'd say, "Now, I'm all right. I don't need nothing. But it'd be mighty fine of you if you come on by and drop something on in for these good folk here." And sure enough, folks would come on up, thanking the band and giddy up himself, and they'd put in a quarter, a dollar, a nickel or so. That old woman, when she got up there, she went down into her ample bosom and pulled out a small purse, opened it up, and after looking around, pulled out $20 and put it right there in the case smile on her face. And out the door, folks went. As young ladies were streaming out the door, they started to look around for that fiddle dancer. Where'd he go? They started to ask themselves questions. Did you see him? Did you get his name? Who is Peoples? Is he married? Have a girlfriend? Nobody had an answer. But nobody worried about it much. As Jeremiah, giddy up himself, gave that money to everybody in the band and put down his fiddle and his bow and locked it up, the only thing folks worried about was the next time they'd be able to hear Giddy Up play. And then maybe, just maybe, that fiddle dancer would come back once again.